Well, they can't see our feet.
It takes a second to get started. Welcome back, everyone. We're going to get started with our second panel of many distinguished journalists, and I'm pleased to introduce its moderator, Ron Thomas, who is the director of the journalism program at Morehouse. Ron.
Hi, well, it's my pleasure to be here, and I've been at three of the last four of your conferences, media law conferences, and I've been a co-moderator before, so this is really a treat to come back. It's particularly a treat for me because I direct the journalism and sports program at Morehouse College, and I teach sports reporting and basic news writing. And so certainly in our class, we've been talking about the challenges, particularly the Trump administration has presented for the media. So this is a very timely topic. And in fact, I'm very glad that five of my students got here, I think before I did, to come to this workshop. So I just would like them to stand, my students from Morehouse College. That applause alone has earned them the extra credit they get. So today, I wanted to start by introducing our distinguished panel, and then we're going to have a little bit of historical information about the First Amendment presented by one of the presenters, and then we will show some quick video. And then each of the panelists will talk about one particular area of First Amendment challenges that they're particularly interested in. And after that, we will open it up for questions and answers. So first, I'd like to introduce Tony Maddox. Tony is Executive Vice President and Managing Director of CNN International, which reaches more than 348 million households worldwide. He's based in Atlanta, and he's responsible for an international news and information portfolio that includes five CNN services in English, CNN Espanol, and CNN Turk, CNN in Chile, Philippines, and Indonesia. And under his leadership, CNN has recently received many prestigious journalism awards, including the Royal Television Society's Best Breaking News Coverage for their coverage of the terrorist attacks in Paris in 2016. So, Tony, just wave your hand. People know who you are. Okay, thank you. Next, I'd like to introduce Kevin Riley. Kevin is the editor-in-chief of the Atlanta Journal-Constitution. He's responsible for all news content for the AJC's print and digital products and has been in that position since 2011. Previously, he was editor-in-chief of the Dayton, Ohio Daily News, and he started his career in the Daily News copy desk and served as both sports and features editor and then ran its online business. So, Kevin, I think you waved already.
Yeah.
Okay. Next, I'd like to introduce Kevin Sack. Kevin is senior writer for the New York Times, based in Atlanta, who produces long-form narrative projects for the newspaper's investigations team. He has written broadly about national affairs for more than three decades and has shared in three Pulitzer Prizes. During more than 20 years with the Times, he has served as bureau chief in Atlanta and Albany, covered healthcare for the National Desk, and reported extensively on race, the South, and domestic politics. Kevin? And then finally, Teresa Stiles is a former CBS News journalist. Many of her credits with CBS reports include such Emmy, Peabody, and Columbia DuPont award-winning documentaries as Teddy with Roger Mudd, The CIA's Secret Army with Bill Moyer, Blacks in America with the late Ed Bradley, and The Defense of the United States with Dan Rather and Bob Schieffer. She also worked with the late Walter Cronkite and Andy Rooney. She has published and presented throughout the world on the topic of the media. She's a recipient of the 2012 University of North Carolina Board of Governors Award for Excellence in Teaching, and most importantly, she's currently my colleague at Morehouse as an adjunct English and Journalism professor. Well, the foundation for all of this is the First Amendment, and I know you can see it, but I thought I'd just read it just to affirm it. The First Amendment reads that Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech, or of the press, or the right of the people peaceably to assemble and petition the government for a redress of grievances. And Teresa Stiles will start by talking a little bit about the history and background of the First Amendment.
Good morning, everybody. Hopefully you're hearing me. Let's start with the knowledge that the First Amendment presents tremendous challenges. We heard that in the opening session with the trends of current day trends. It is a fact of life, and we in the media know why. Technology has afforded all those who are citizen journalists, those who blog, those who are on Twitter, Facebook, technology has given all an opportunity to speak their truth and at the same time feel the American tradition of press freedom protects them. For our discussion, I offer a refresher on our basic understanding of the First Amendment, which requires safeguarding press and speech. America is committed to this. For a moment, as difficult as it may be, relive the Florida tragedy, or any violent tragedy, and the outcry from students. Relive the moments with the knowledge that those who are so committed will not move an inch on their rights and their support of them. So how did we get here? During the era of the colonial, patriot, and revolutionary press, Americans relied heavily on four printed pages to obtain news and information. Established media journalists continue to argue that it was the media that shaped American history boldly, profoundly, and profusely. Thrifty Benjamin Franklin, I love to tell this story, and I'm sure we all know this, who was also an editor, supported the Revolutionary War effort, basically with his editorial cartoon that said, "Join or die." And it was because he was so outraged that he had to pay a special tax for the paper used to print his publication. So, if we consider the importance of the press in shaping American history, we need only depict a scene following the Revolutionary War. The farmers, the patriots, the thinkers, all reeling in their victory over the British Empire. Please consider the press. The editors of these papers who posed this question, would there be a free flow of information that would bind a nation together? Or would it be a preservation of local voices up and down the eastern seaboard? Everybody's got their laws. The founding fathers, the thinkers, Jefferson and Adams, took time to reflect on that question. As they said in meetings, perhaps even around the kitchen table, Jefferson began to recall what had happened a century ago across the Atlantic when Puritan John Milton endorsed the freedom of discussion because he wanted to defend the merits of divorce based on what Henry VIII was wanting. And the Protestant philosopher John Locke, who in his writings established ideas that could be used against press restrictions. Understandably, when Jefferson and the other thinkers began to consider the newspaper editor's question of what will bind us together, a question that should be revisited in the current climate of political and racial divisiveness, Jefferson thankfully placed ideas, the ideas of Milton and Locke, into actions, resulting in our Bill of Rights, Constitution, and the Declaration. The First Amendment is a challenge, as we've said, and I'm here to say I keep seeing so many things happening daily that give me a pause. But what has had a substantial impact for you lawyers out here on our understanding of freedom of press is the concept of libel. From Henry VIII, who gave us prior restraint, which meant that no paper would be printed or distributed without governmental review or approval. And if you did not do that, you would face cruel or deadly punishment. From Henry VIII to Trump, who accuses the media of fake news, press freedom is always in question. Fake news gets more traffic than real news. Those who develop what some consider fake are protected not only because of historical press freedoms, but also because the courts have over time shown an individual's right to defend him or herself against a charge to become more flexible and fair. However, the increase in fake news demands solutions. Let me be clear, fake news is our enemy. As one official stated, there are a lot of con artists out there. So, a reasonable response could be to support the actions of Google and Facebook, where they have begun to favor legacy media. That is truly not enough. It is complicated. Social media has financial losses and gains to consider. As a positive step, the New York Times is being featured more on their pages. So are others, but this is not a cure. Hopefully all schools of journalism will develop social media standards. I end by saying it harkens back to a statement of an earlier politician, N.P. Crisp, who in fact was the grandson-in-law of Jefferson, who in 1828 said, "Could it be so arranged that every newspaper, when printed on one side, should be handed over to the press of an adversary to be printed on the other, thus presenting to every reader both sides of every question, truth would always have a fair chance. But such a remedy is not ideal."
Well, thank you very much. I really appreciate that. Peter? So we flashed above President Trump's pretty famous tweet now, in which he said, "The fake news media, parentheses, failing New York at New York Times, NBC News, ABC, and CBS, and CNN, is not my enemy. It is the enemy of the American people." And what will follow would be one person, important person's response to that. Senator Jeff Flake from Arizona.
"2017 was a year we saw the truth, objective, empirical, evidence-based truth, more battered and abused than at any time in the history of our country, at the hands of the most powerful figure in our government. It was a year which saw the White House enshrine alternative facts into the American lexicon, as justification for what used to be simply called old-fashioned falsehoods. It was a year in which an unrelenting daily assault on the constitutionally protected free speech was launched by the same White House, an assault that is as unprecedented as it is unwarranted. The enemy of the people was how the President of the United States called the free press in 2017. It is a testament to the condition of our democracy that our own president uses words infamously spoken by Joseph Stalin to describe his enemies. It bears noting that so fraught with malice was the phrase enemy of the people that even Nikita Khrushchev forbade its use, telling the Soviet Communist Party that the phrase had been introduced by Stalin for the purpose of, quote, annihilating such individuals, unquote, who disagreed with the Supreme Leader. When a figure in power reflexively calls any press that doesn't suit him fake news, it is that person who should be the figure of suspicion, not the press. Now we are told via Twitter that today the president intends to announce his choice for the, quote, most corrupt and dishonest media awards. It beggars belief that an American president would engage in such a spectacle. But here we are. To call the Russian matter a hoax, as the president has done so many times, is a falsehood. We know the attacks orchestrated by the Russian government during the election were real. They constitute a grave threat to both American sovereignty and to our national security. It is in the interest of every American to get to the bottom of this matter, wherever the investigation leads. Together, united in this purpose to do our jobs under the Constitution, without regard to party or party loyalty, let us resolve to be allies of the truth and not partners in its destruction."
Thank you very much. So in light of what we've heard about founding fathers such as Thomas Jefferson and Madison and their thought process, and then to what we are dealing with now in the current administration, I turn to Kevin Riley to talk a little bit about how all of this is impacting the news we all receive every day through the Atlanta Journal-Constitution.
Thank you, and thank you for inviting me today to be part of this panel. So let me try this. You know, pretty high-minded stuff, the First Amendment, the President, some of the most important news organizations in the world. So as the leader of a regional newspaper, I feel very strongly that if we are in fact engaged in a battle to defend and protect the First Amendment, it is most likely to be won very locally. I think that the pressure that we feel in the AJC newsroom and the kinds of things that we talk about have a lot to do with getting people to understand the role it plays in their everyday life, including the quality of that life and the accountability of that government. And that is, I think, where I would say we're focused, and I hope we can count on all of you to help us with that focus, because I think that to a guy sitting, you know, watching TV in Kennesaw, some of this can seem maybe not as important to him as it should be. And when they see a reporter from a national news organization complaining that the president won't answer the question at a press conference, to an average person, I worry that that seems like someone complaining that their job is hard. And none of us want to hear someone complain about how hard their job is. So what we have to do, and what we try to do at the AJC, is to make sure people see how the First Amendment is connected to them in their everyday life. And whenever we talk about it, I think it's very important to talk about it. It's important to emphasize that when we seek a public record, any citizen could seek that same public record. And I guess I would just keep that in mind. We're going to hear from some brilliant people because I got to be part of the phone call before we did this panel. And what you're going to hear is extremely important stuff. I would just bring us all back to it's right here in the living rooms of people who live in Metro Atlanta, where people have to be persuaded of the value of the First Amendment and its impact on their lives.
Thank you, Kevin. want to turn next to Kevin Sack from the New York Times. And Kevin, the president has called it the failing New York Times. What would be your response to that characterization?
Hi, everybody. Well, I bring you greetings from the failing New York Times. And I really wanted to talk a little bit about what I see as sort of a heartening but obviously unintended side effect of the attacks we're seeing on the press coming from the White House and on the from the emergence of fake news, which is that there's been, short-term at least, a real reaction among consumers to the attack on truth by the purveyor of fake news. People may not be able to vote with their fingers for another 2.5 years, but they're voting with their minds and their pocketbooks. And a handful of national news organizations like mine have been the beneficiaries. We're the outliers, so I'm sure Kevin can attest. The benefits not being felt in the same way, at least, by local news organizations, which have different types of pressures because of the market that they serve. But I like to joke that after a decade or more of desperate flailing around trying to find a business model that would guide us through the rocky shoals of our digital transformation, we've finally found one, and his name is Donald Trump. Now we just have to make sure that he gets reelected and succeeded by President Palin. Some of the reaction is protests, some of it's a thirst for facts, but let me throw a few, maybe more than a few numbers at you. The Times now has 3.6 million subscribers. 2.6 million of them are digital only. That's an increase of 42% over the fourth quarter of 2016, up from 1.8 million, essentially since the election. That 1 year increase, if you think about it, is about equivalent to twice the population of the city of Atlanta. Is it Trump? Well, you decide. We added 132,000 subscribers in the first 2.5 weeks after Election Day. That's 10 times the normal rate. We're successfully making the transition, finally, from an advertising-based revenue model to a digital circulation-based one. Our subscription revenues were over $1 billion in 2017, 60% of our total revenue, which obviously is a big switch from when newspapers were advertising-based revenue models. Our print advertising continues to plummet, but because of the increases in digital, our total revenue for the year increased 8%, and 10% in the fourth quarter of last year. Our stock price has doubled since Election Day. In 2015, the paper's corporate leadership set a goal of doubling digital revenue to $800 million by 2020. Many people thought that was unrealistic. We got $600 million last year, way ahead of schedule. And the impact of that has been profound in our newsroom. We're hiring. Not many newspapers are. We hired 130 people for our editorial staff last year. We added reporting strength in Washington, our investigations team, which I'm part of. We added four reporters to investigations in the last year, each one a Pulitzer winner or finalist, including one this week, one that was announced this week. He was an expert on technology and social media, so I wonder what she'll be writing about. We've added bureaus in places like Sydney, Australia, and Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. We're trying lots of new things, podcasts, collaborations with local newspapers. So there's a lot of upside coming out of this reaction. The downside is, I think there's a lot of fear in our newsroom about the long-term impact of the labeling that the Trump administration has done. And we saw the effectiveness of this in the campaign. Long after Donald Trump is gone, I think there will still be a significant portion of the population that identifies the senator from Florida as Little Marco, and the one from Texas as Lion Ted. And we may be known for generations as the failing and corrupt New York Times. And that's a problem. I assure you that I see it in the faces of people that I interview. Whereas you used to see sort of a raised eyebrow, like, what's the New York Times doing here? Now you get chortles and smirks. A colleague recently introduced himself to some folks in Nevada. He was reporting a travel story about a cowboy poetry slam, I think. And the person said, are you really with the New York Times, or are you in the witness protection program? And the more I think about it, I'm not even sure exactly what that means, but I know it's not good. So it's sort of a strange divide, like all others in our country at the moment. The assault on real news has bolstered and enhanced our previously shaky status with large numbers of consumers, while degrading it with others, regardless of the truth of the matter.
Okay, well, thank you very much. And next, Tony Maddox, and particularly I think it's important to have him here because of his position, he can present sort of a international focus also on the news and the reaction to the atmosphere about the news.
Well, thank you for the invitation to speak and to address that directly. I would just assure people that the levels of interest in the U.S. and in this administration are unprecedented internationally. Every time we do these stories, we have phone-ins, we have people the opportunity to interact socially with us. There's a huge level of interest. So be in no doubt that this conversation isn't purely a U.S. domestic conversation. It's extended abroad. And also the toxic term fake news has also extended abroad as well and used by dictators basically to try and shut up the press in their own countries. Now, I should start by saying that in the time that I've been doing the job, I've always believed that relationships between the press and government do need a touch of Tabasco. It shouldn't be too cozy. And it is false to think that these tensions between the press and the presidential administration are a new thing. Certainly the way in which this one is being portrayed is a new thing, and the dialogue is new. But it's important by way of context to understand that this has always been a relationship with some edge. But I think in the past, the understanding has always been that the press is trying to do its job. And even though there might be criticism of how the press is doing the job, and by the way, sometimes legitimate criticism, we're not above criticism. We've got to have humility in our line of work. But there's always been an idea that maybe you got that wrong, but that we're trying to get it right, but you got it wrong. Whereas now, I think the part of the dialogue has changed. And I think the sustained use of fake news, the assertion that the press is the enemy of the people, what we're seeing is a concerted, sustained attempt to denigrate the legitimacy of legitimate journalism. The reason for doing this is quite clear. It's so that when they report things you don't like, you can quickly just throw this name at them and not have to answer the difficult truths. The vast majority of stories that have been described as fake news, whether generated by us or by the New York Times or whoever else, have generally turned out to be true. That is the truth of the matter. And what we're seeing here is a weaponizing of the language to denigrate and undermine one of the fundamental principles of the First Amendment, which is a free press.
All right, well, thanks very much. And I wanted to add one observation of my own about the effect of all of this. I'm hoping that the effect will be that a lot more young people will be start following the news and will see journalism as an exciting career to pursue. I that comes to mind particularly for me because I was in grad school at Northwestern in journalism school during the Watergate era. And certainly a lot of the young journalists who came into our newsrooms in, let's say, the decade following Watergate decided to pursue journalism because of Watergate and the fact that they admired the work, particularly the Washington Post and the New York Times. And it was a profession that, you know, gave them a sense of importance and excitement, some adventure, and also a commitment to public service. And I'm hoping that all of those things will combine once again and generate a new group of young journalists, which I would love to see all of them come to Morehouse. Next, we'd like to take questions from the audience. So the best thing is just raise your hand, and I'll call upon you. And please try to. It might be best if you stand so that your voice projects, and hopefully everyone can hear your question. In the back, yes.
Is the term fake news, is it about the quality of the information, or is it about the source of the information? Because y'all are talking about legacy media. There was a report this week. Dead reckoning laid out basically that certain sources can't be guilty of pushing fake news. So, what's y'all's definition?
Just a quick summation of her question was: is the term, when Trump uses the term fake news, is he using it to talk about the quality of the news or the source of the news?
I'll start if you like. He's usually talking about stories he doesn't like. But there's more to the definition than that. There's a lot more to the definition than that. So there are stories which are out there which are people think are right and they're just wrong. And the origin of those stories is where the interest lies, I feel. I think there are clear attempts on stories to generate a story which suits a certain belief. Whether or not it's true doesn't matter. In fact, it isn't true. It's made up. But it actually supports or undermines one of the arguments. We've seen one in the past 2 or 3 days, these disgusting attempts to portray some of these children from this massacre as paid actors. No evidence at all for that. And that then gets peddled and circulated out. The challenge with social media and the challenge with how people consume media today, I think it's very important that the students here today, because this is a particular hobby horse of mine, is it's now possible to construct your own news feed, which largely has stuff you agree with in it. And so you have certain writers, certain publications, and people never really step outside of that. And things have become so partisan on some issues that people don't ever have access to an alternate point of view. And so if someone peddles a story which suits your purposes, and it goes into that mainstream media, the fact that people believe it, it's almost become an item of faith as opposed to an item of fact. You know, where does the story come from? How has it been sourced? How has it been spread around? So that's the problem. Now, that wouldn't be so much of a problem because there's always been people who, you know, sit around in bars and here's what we think and here's what we say and that's what we believe. I don't think about that. But But I think the way in which social media works nowadays is the story about the young boy in Florida became the number one story on YouTube for a while, a spiking story on YouTube. And YouTube's defense of this is, oops, sorry, we're going to try and do better next time. I think it's a time for that argument to run out. And if most people are getting their news via YouTube or via Facebook or via Twitter, then candidly, they've got to exert some of the controls that the New York Times do or the AJC does or we do. I started in papers a long, long time ago with about four or five people. It wasn't accepted. There was only four or five of us. It doesn't matter if most of the stuff is wrong. You know? There's no excuse for it.
To pick up a little bit on that, though, I actually think that, and we've done a bunch of research on this fake news question at the AJC and exactly how we should talk about it and what we should say, and if you're paying attention to any of our marketing, you're starting to see that. But we're trapped. I mean, we've fallen into a rhetorical trap. I mean, a lot of lawyers in the room. We have to prove we're not fake news. It can't be done, right? Prove the negative. And that's really like the discussion we almost have to find a way out of. Because if we're talking about not being fake news, we cannot win that argument.
Then I think we have to really continue to support our standards when we're looking at the fact that facts matter. So how are we going about the whole business of being willing to investigate and come up with balanced stories and those that are accurate? And then it speaks a lot, I think, to a return maybe of interest and support of gatekeepers. I had said to them on the phone that what I have seen happen when we used to call media new media, you know, when we were trying to really deal with moving from traditional to all these new things, then the real words out there were innovate, be sold, or die. So everybody's trying to find their own way. And what resulted is this debate, and again, in where I came out of North Carolina, where we had a big debate over whether or not gatekeepers had a significant role, since everybody could just do their own, become their own citizen journalists, do whatever they want to do. And so then you started seeing that that we were moving away from some of the controls, some of the gatekeepers that we really truly admired and stood up to and supported. So I think that's some of the things, again, going back to standards that need to still be in place and utilized within the curriculums of our schools, and making sure, again, that we just have a mantra. Are you willing to investigate? Are you willing to ask questions? Facts matter.
So I think one of the other difficult aspects of this is how do you edit, how do you control bots? And I think how Facebook and other, particularly other social media institutions, well, they're growing to be an institution, how do they handle editing and vetting, what comes to them as news is going to be critical to the quality of the news the public gets in ensuing years. Okay. Yes?
Sorry, great setup for my question. Section 512C of the Copyright Act has allowed sites like YouTube, services like YouTube, sites like Facebook, to avoid copyright infringement claims because they claim to be the dumb pipes, to use a reference to the internet. So that one of the elements of Section 512C is that you can't make money off of the content that is passing through the pipes. And I apologize for the paraphrasing of the section. But that's exact, and Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act is also at play here, where they want to say we're not responsible for what gets put on our system. And because they've relied on these two exemptions from liability, they've beat traditional journalism at their own game, because they've become the platforms that are worth billions of dollars, even though they don't make that kind of money. So that's the challenge, and now YouTube/Google, the parent company, and Facebook are trying to figure out how they can comply with the public demand for some gatekeeping and other things, and still satisfy Section 512C to avoid liability when they put up the New York Times articles and Atlanta Journal Constitution content without permission or payment. So this is a real, what's that word called? Sticking point. And I wonder how y'all have seen that, if y'all have noticed that, and also what you think of Facebook's attempt, I think it's Facebook, it might be YouTube, hiring 10,000 human beings who are going to vet the content.
Kevin, well, I'd be afraid of 10,000 editors looking for me, just for the record. I don't have to hear that many, and they're a lot of trouble.
Go ahead, Kevin, I think.
No. This one's sort of above my pay grade, I think.
Well, I mean, you know, there was that famous analysis the Times did a few years back that showed more people read Times, New York Times content on Huffington Post than at the Times site. So it's a real difficult prospect for us in media, and I think, you know, we for years hoped someone would do something about it, and then it became apparent that there wasn't that much we could do about it. And we started getting into the same game and doing our own aggregation and some other things. But I mean, I probably go too far here, but I think when the history of our age is written, Mark Zuckerberg will be one of its great villains, to be honest with you, because when we think about any of you who've seen the Post or you've ever visited with the history of some of the media titans of our country's history, they didn't typically say something like, oh, I didn't have anything to do with that. You know, they typically took a stand at important moments. So I think it will play out over time, but we, you know, in the media world, companies trying to battle over copyright and our own rights to use things and stuff, it gets to be a very difficult thing that it is not something we've been able to solve.
There could be a positive out of this. I mean, one of the tragedies of the past 20 years, 30 years, I'd say 20 years primarily, has been the huge decline in local journalism. I mean, that's been a major loss, not just in the U.S., but focused on the U.S. It's been a major loss in the U.S. And I think local accountability is incredibly powerful and incredibly important, and it's been lost. And I think if Facebook really are going to hire thousands of people to start checking stuff, that's a really positive development. Because there's lots of people who've been trained to do that. There's lots of local news journalists who know how to check out a story. Up until now, there's been this idea that if you can't check something with a logarithm, it can't be checked. That's bullshit.
Yes.
You know, we've been checking stories since we started doing journalism. And the idea that, you know, that all these stories come through, how can we possibly be on top of them? A lot of these stories can be checked in 5 or 10 minutes. We're not talking about major detailed investigations. So they can make a lot of progress. And I think hiring journalists or, you know, some kind of editing level to check them over, a very positive step. I don't know whether they've started doing that yet, but I know they've started talking about it. Doing it's an even more positive step.
We have any questions to the left? Well, is that my student, Jalen? Jalen? Okay.
He's going to get an extra credit.
So Jalen, please stand and press your question.
Okay. What is your advice for young aspiring journalists and writers who want to venture into that career field but are hesitant to like express themselves due to not wanting to cope statements that may seem too ruthless or controversial? Since we're on the topic of freedom of speech.
Sorry, you speak up a little bit, Joe, and I'm
sorry. Okay, sorry about that. I said, what is your advice for young, aspiring journalists who want to venture into this career field but are hesitant to express themselves due to not wanting to quote statements that may seem too controversial?
Yeah. Okay. Do you want to repeat his question?
Just the last couple of sentences. I'm so sorry. Most of us aren't here. I've got your level of hearing. I'm afraid.
Okay. No, I can repeat it. He was saying, what advice would the panel have for young aspiring journalists who are concerned in expressing themselves because they're concerned about whether what they're saying is accurate or a legitimate opinion?
Well, you'd always want to be sure that what you can stand over what you do. I mean, that's a fundamental part of the job, and the time spent checking so that you can do that is important. I think what is also important for journalists nowadays is to realize that this has never been a job for the faint-hearted, and you need thick skin to do this. You know, if you write something now which someone doesn't like, they're going to come after you, you know, and it'll be sustained, it'll be mean, it'll be horrible, it'll be personal, and there's lots of ways in which people can come after you, you know. For us at CNN, sure it's true at the New York Times, sure it's true everywhere. But, you know, people like Jim Acosta, who sort of made the stand and was called out for fake news directly by Trump. Now, the amount of flack that that generates is considerable. So if you believe you're doing the right thing and you've checked out your stories, you're just going to have to develop the fortitude to stand over it and do it. It's a great job. It's an important job. And if people are saying mean things about you, then it's probably a sign that you're getting somewhere.
I certainly agree with all that. The only thing I would add is that obviously it's a different time than when we came up as journalists. And the standards, I'd like to think, have not changed. They certainly shouldn't have changed. We still, I think, at most mainstream organizations believe, you know, in stringent reporting and editing and careful attention to facts and fact-checking and context and fairness and all the things that guide us. What you guys face that we didn't face when we were up-and-coming journalists is the kind of exposure that you get. I started out at the Atlanta Constitution, and my readers held me to account, but they were just my readers. They weren't, you know, it wasn't a worldwide audience like any journalist may find themselves having these days. So it only, I think, adds to the pressure to make sure that you've got it right. And we spend a whole lot of time, we always have, but I think perhaps even more so now, fact-checking stories, going back to sources, making sure we've got every nuance as right as we can get it.
I think another change in media is the volume of comment you get back from readers. I used to work for the San Francisco Chronicle, and we had a letters to the editor section, which we ran once a week. And, you know, we get, I don't know how many letters in the sports section, maybe we get a couple a week, and, we might run five, and that would be it, really. And once in a while, a reader would call in, and once in a while, a reader would write a letter. But now, you know, you publish a story, and within 5 minutes, you can have 20 comments about it. So the volume of good comments, but also bad comments, to the point of vitriol, that a reporter can receive is much higher than it ever was before. And as Tony said, so you have to be tough enough to take it and not let it shake you from what you feel is from your confidence as a reporter, no matter what platform you're using.
And also, I just want to make this point as well. I run CNN International, and around the world, we deal with journalists who risk their very lives to report. You know, people will go to jail, they'll be tortured, they'll be killed. You know, they believe that what they're doing, you know, this pursuit of truth, this holding people accountable, such a fundamental principle in countries with nothing like as well developed a democracy as the U.S., and they're prepared to put it all on the line for that. You know, sometime when I've got, you know, a dozen sort of emails observing that, you know, I'm an idiot or something, you know, you set it against that, so what, you know, this job at its highest level has attracted some of the finest people, and you're going to follow in that tradition and do it with your eyes wide open and be proud about it.
Gentlemen in the front.
Does everybody remember when you were in math class and your math teacher, when you turned in the paper, said, show your work? The question I have for the panel is, have journalists done enough to show their work? And would showing more of the process help with credibility?
Richard, I think you're leading the witness, but I'm happy to. My answer is no. In fact, I would make reference to a story we ran on the front page in Sunday's newspaper, for those of you who read it, about Georgia Tech's basketball coach, and he's got this lawsuit that he's filed and this other guy's filed, and they're going back and forth with all these horrible accusations. We had a long discussion about that story, and the reporter ended up writing it in the first person. And one of the reasons I believe we should do that was because it revealed the reporting process. The reporting is a character almost in the story, because we knew that story was going to be very difficult. We have a great loyalty of Georgia Tech readers, by the way, we really do. I felt like the more they could see what the reporter went through to get the story, they would see how hard the reporter worked to be fair and find out what was really going on. Personal favorite part of the story is the guy who filed the lawsuit against the coach, the reporter, Alan Judd, got his mom on the phone. And his mom said something like, quote, don't believe any, everything that comes out of his mouth is a lie. His mom said that. I'm calling your mom, Richard. I want to see what she says about you. But no, I think that that is part of winning the battle, is letting people know what we do, why we do it, how we do it, whenever we can. And I would say that at least in the print world, there's been more reluctance to do that that has been shaking loose over time. Because I find when I talk to non-journalists and students and people in the community, they're astounded by what we go through before we put something in the newspaper. And in this business, we all know, you know, when I read something Kevin's done in the Times, a part of the joy of reading is like, oh, I wonder how he got that, or look how he got this, right? And I don't think the average person who, I mean, the average people are who not only who we serve, but who ultimately have to believe in the First Amendment. And it's really important to show what we do, why we do it, how we do it, and why it's worth doing.
I think it does make sense, Richard. It helps at least around the margins. And we're trying to take steps in that direction in different ways that provide some transparency. I mean, we want, in ways that we didn't before, we want our readers to get to know our reporters and writers and photographers. But obviously that builds a relationship and it builds some credibility. And we've done this in a variety of ways. We have a podcast that has drawn a fantastic audience called The Daily, where every day it's a half hour, usually devoted to one or two of the top stories of the day, and they bring reporters on to talk about the process of how the story was developed. We have a feature on Page 2 every day, in which either the reporter who wrote sort of the big story of the day, or somebody writes about the reporter who wrote the big story of the day. And that column's purpose is to introduce folks to some of the reporting process and walk them through what some of the challenges were. We also, obviously, digital now gives us the ability to literally show our work by linking to documents, by embedding documents and other source material directly into the story, so that readers can see for themselves. I think all those things do help. There are limits, how much we want or should give away about the process. But I think it's something we recognize that's necessary in this environment.
Next question, the lady in the back.
So in this age where the trend seems to be more on the side of the stories.
Miss, could you speak louder, please?
Yeah, sorry. In this age where the trend seems to be more on the side of defending stories that are presumed false, how do you balance protecting your sources while still defending the stories? And do you anticipate that creating issues further down the line, will be more than talk potentially as well?
The nut of her question was, in this era where the news media outlets have to be so defensive about their product, how do you go about proving its credibility and yet protecting your sources?
You protect your sources.
Protect your sources.
Period.
Yeah, nothing, that's it.
That can't change.
Totally.
Okay. We have that answer. Gentleman here in the gray shirt, way in the back.
Stacked against the media with this presidency than other presidencies? Do you guys feel more pressure to get the truth out there when the whole world is kind of really trying to discredit you guys? Like, how's the pressure or,
okay.
Yeah.
I got it. So his question is, does the media feel more pressure to get the news out and do it in a credible way, considering the fact we are getting so much extra scrutiny than in the past?
Yes, I mean, but I don't know that's anything new. I mean, I'd be interested in what some of my fellow panelists think, but the urgency to get news out, the intense pressure to make sure it's accurate, the constant searching for the most important stories to do, that never goes away. because, you know, I mean, as Tony pointed out, I mean, I had this discussion with, you know, when you're the editor of a newspaper like the AJC, you get to go talk to Rotary Clubs and people like that all the time. So I was up at the Alpharetta Rotary Club a few weeks ago. And one of the questions I got was about unnamed sources, and in particular, these different stories that had come out, particularly in the Times and the Post. And I made the same statement Tony did. I said, I would invite you to go back over every one of those stories that had unnamed sources, and then decide as it played out whether or not it was true. And I think what you will find, because I pay attention to this, we use both of those wire services, and so we care about how accurate they are. And that yeah, a story comes out with unnamed sources, it gets called fake news, and then 3 days later, confirmed. And what I said was, newspapers in particular, but all news organizations that, you know, certainly that sit up here, we don't use unnamed sources unless there's no other way to do it. The standards for using unnamed sources are very, very demanding. Reporters would rather not use them because of what they have to go through to get approval to use them. And by the time you've decided to use an unnamed source, you are so sure on this story that you are not going to publish it unless, if you have even the slightest doubt of its accuracy. So.
Next question. Right here.
Well, I saw her first, and then I'll come back.
All right, okay. Well, so, not to make it too complicated, but, you know, Trump has obviously been a hugely corrosive force.
Talk a bit louder, if you don't mind.
Trump has obviously been a hugely corrosive force for the media in the last year, in one sense. Competing organizations who don't abide by the same standards, I'm thinking of Fox, are another corrosive effect, and I'm just wondering how you deal. You just have to simply ignore them and do your job so that people can tell the difference? Or is there a way that the media should be addressing other major media outlets who have a huge audience, obviously, who are not doing the kind of job that you're doing and who are, in fact, might be misleading people? And to that end, I just would encourage, and Brian Stelter was here a year or two ago and talked a lot about media literacy, and I do think that needs more from all of you because you're so steeped in it, and you know journalism students are learning it, but the, you know, educated people even, you know, are not so familiar with how hard it is to get permission to use a you know, an unnamed source. And so, I mean, the Fox is as corrosive and longer term than Trump, and maybe you can't deal with it, and somebody else has to, and maybe nobody can. But that combined with media literacy, I just think is.
Well, I think that sooner or later it might just erode, because if you go back, you know, when I was talking about the colonial patriot revolutionary press, then what followed that was the party press, which was that the papers were all about you are hired if you feel a certain way. But we've seen over time that died down, especially when people started taking journalism seriously. And they wanted to make sure that standards were in place. They wanted that accuracy was there. Because again, coming out of the partisan papers, that was their role. So we've seen with the advent of cable, this whole movement to have, okay, this side. But over time, I think it'll just die out. And we'll go back with the next generation that has to really deal with hate speech. You know, we haven't talked about that. But and then seeing that the students coming out of Florida are so strong in their commitment, there's hope that the next generation will really look more seriously at that, but I do believe it's not going to be here forever. We will go back to serious journalism.
And I think you're right that we do have an obligation to do more reporting about ourselves. This should be a golden age for media reporters like Brian Stelter, and obviously other newspapers, including ours, have them. it's challenging for them because of the environment. And the real solution ultimately is probably going to be lower down the chain in the schools. You know, we're going to have to start teaching in some way media literacy, as you put it. Yeah. There's a former colleague of mine, a very close friend named Alan Miller, who used to work for the Los Angeles Times, who a decade ago saw what was ahead and started a nonprofit called the News Literacy Project. Based in Washington, And they've gone about, over the last decade, putting together a curriculum that they are now introducing in schools all over the country that teaches kids how to distinguish between real and fake news. And, you know, a sad development that that kind of organization is necessary, but I think it is. I encourage you to check it out online.
Missy, you had a question?
As media students, what can we do to change the perception of fake news?
What can students do to change the perception of fake news?
I think just be educated consumers. And like I was just talking about, you may need to take an extra step and go about educating yourself about what fake news is, where it appears, how it appears, and how to distinguish it.
We had a gentleman with his hand up earlier, I believe, over here. Yes, you.
With the current focus on everything Trump, are you concerned that other stories are getting pushed aside?
Yes. candidly, I understand why. I mean, I do think that, as I was saying at the start, we're seeing unprecedented levels of interest in news, which is, you know, it's a large part to do with what's going on within the US right now. I think it's easier if you're CNN because we've got all these platforms. We have, you know, our sort of massive digital presence. We've got CNN International, HLN, CNN Domestic. So we can pick up, we can pick up most of the stories. But for those who've only got 28 minutes or a certain number of pages or a certain amount of space, yeah, I do think it's a problem. And because you can only put so much stuff in there and you can only focus your resources in so many ways. But this is the story of the age, and this is the story that, you know, the Times numbers and lots of other numbers show there is the levels of interest in. So it's always the editor challenge is what goes in and what doesn't go in, and there's always reporters quick to tell you that you're not doing enough on what they want you to be doing, and they might be right half the time. But I do think it's a challenge, for sure.
Is the current goal, I guess, for the digital newspaper to get clicks? You're going to report, or have a tendency to perhaps report things that are interesting as opposed to things that are important. For example, a tweet might be very interesting, but in the grand scheme of things, a policy or bill enacted would be more important. And it seems like there's a lot of media focus on things that are interesting, but not necessarily terribly important.
Yeah, I know that Kevin have a go at this because he runs a newspaper, but I mean, for me, I think one of the challenges always is how do we make the important interesting? That's always our challenge. A good example for me is Brexit, which is fantastically important and searingly dull. we're talking about the intricacies of EU legislation and overseas trading legislation and Britain trading rights, and, you know, literally the people doing the negotiations aren't interested in this. So you've got to try and make it accessible to other people. But it is unquestionably a very, very important story. So you always look for good access points and nice color stories and good individuals. And there's various journalistic ways around that. But you can't get into the policy of, you know, serving people stewed vegetables every day and say, this is good for you, you must eat it. You know, it's our job to make this as appetizing as we can.
Yeah, how much time do we have on this one? really quickly, of course, that's the eternal battle for any journalistic and news organization. But let's just be frank. I mean, we don't run comics and crosswords because it's really great journalism. We have run them for perhaps a century because they're interesting and attract people to continue to read the newspaper so that they're there when we want to serve them their vegetables, right? So one of the ways, you know, Trump is less an issue for us, and if you want to hang around afterwards, I could talk for an hour with you about what we know about what we should be doing relative to Trump. But the way I explain it is like with our education reporting. We devote an enormous amount of our resources to education. I mean, we have reporters covering all the big districts in Metro Atlanta. We have a person covering higher education, statewide education issues. We have an education columnist and blogger. And they, you know, that's a rich beat with a lot of policy issues, important things. People love to stand up and say nothing more important than the education of our children. With these shootings, becomes even more important.
But if you're after clicks as an education reporter, what you'd really like is a teacher having sex with you. Because you can make your digital numbers for the year in a day if it's the right amount of detail. If the cops could just actually give you the incident report, you're in good shape. And it's sad, and it's, I mean, I don't say that, you know, without a lot of, you know, I mean, both as a journalist and a human being, realizing that's terrible, you know, and nothing to joke about. But it's this constant balancing act. If you don't keep people interested in what you're doing, they're not going to be there when you do something really important. And how much of that could you do? Well, I would confess, and I think others here would too, if I ever get that figured out exactly right, I'll let you know. But I'm not, every day I look at our newspaper, I look at our website, and don't believe we have it quite right. But we'll try again tomorrow. So.
Well, on that uplifting note, in many different ways, I want to thank the panel. I think you've been terrific.
No break. We're going to get a new panel up here and get started in just a couple minutes.
Thank you all very much for coming.
Go ahead, listen.